Soul clap. 1, 2, 3.
This guy. Hey, back with another episode of the Iron Culture Podcast. Thrilled to be reunited with the one and only Eric Helms, who recently just competed in a bodybuilding show. I want to talk about that on another episode. This episode, Eric, today is interesting because we're talking about a hot topic, something that maybe our community, our little enclave, the iron culture, the lifting culture, either might not be as familiar with or might have some preconceived ideas, and that is CrossFit.
Yeah, and we're really lucky. Well, first, thanks for the congratulations on competing in the bodybuilding stage.
You look great.
And
you look great.
Thank you, brother. I appreciate it.
Like, you actually did, straight up. Everyone should check it out. Hold on. Let me shout out your Instagram quickly. Helms3DMJ. You could check out, he does a comparison photo with Frank Zane. Highly recommended. Go on.
It is not a comparison photo.
No, that's true. Homage.
It is an homage. Yes. I'm absolutely not trying to compare myself to Zane. It was me emulating someone who I greatly respect, who got me motivated originally in bodybuilding.
Yes. So, I fucked up.
So how dare you?
Oh. And the fact that we want to sit down and chat with Frank too. Ooh, that's my bad. The legend himself.
We're going to have to start off with, I'll start apologizing for you when I introduce myself to him. And he'll be like, I don't know who either one of you are. Please, how did you find my residence?
Please leave my house. This is a private property.
I have a gun. Yeah. So, we got a little off topic there. But CrossFit, we're really fortunate to be joined by two, honestly, very influential people in CrossFit, Marcus Philly and James Fitzgerald. For those who don't know, James Fitzgerald is probably one of the most prominent and respected coaches and educators in the world of, you know, high-intensity functional fitness, end quote. And he was the world's fittest man in the first CrossFit Games. So he is the inaugural world's fittest man, as we talk about on the podcast. And Marcus Philly is someone who remained as a highly competitive CrossFit competitor while the sport rapidly grew. I think he has been to the CrossFit Games as an individual or on the team 6 times, I believe, from over the span of 2010 to 2016, if I got my facts right, which is pretty impressive because the field got way more competitive towards the end of that time period. So kudos to him. Both are thinkers. Both come from an academic background and then shifted, not necessarily shifted, but came from academics and then went to coaching and competing. So we had a really interesting discussion. I think a lot of my prior beliefs about CrossFit or initial reactions were challenged over the years and were challenged even more in this conversation, which I think is probably the main benefit.
Yeah, and I think that is the function of Iron Culture when we talk about this podcast or our mission statement, and that is to try and find the common ground of the different lifting communities, the fracturing that has occurred over the last 100 years when we take a look at what physical fitness is all about, and it is always tied with self-betterment or improvement and different training modalities. Eric actually mentioned before that CrossFit in ways almost embodies the original idea of lifting a little closer than the specificity that has evolved with lifting culture when we talk about powerlifting, bodybuilding, strongman training, weightlifting. So I think this podcast will be illuminating for a lot of individuals out there that might have some prior beliefs, myself included, entering this conversation. Eric, as always, is fantastic at selecting the guests to have, you know, a thought-provoking conversation. This is our episode on CrossFit with both Marcus and James. We hope you guys enjoy the episode. If you do, remember, it helps us out. A rating review on iTunes. We appreciate everyone, and let's get started with the episode. Hey, James, it's one of those things, you know, when they have team building exercises like HR, it's mandatory in corporate, you know, in order to have that team building. So it's like, I'm going to have a trust exercise where you fall and I'm going to catch you. And then it never works out. That was us with the clap. But we're all reunited here. Welcome to another episode of Iron Culture Podcast with my co-host, Eric Helms. We have a special episode today. We're joined by James, I say one of the world's fittest men because you were the fittest man in 2007. It's an absolute title. No one can relinquish it. It's permanent.
Yeah, I think the one that I use now is inaugural. I think that, like, that creates a hierarchy of it.
I like it.
Yeah.
Nice. Yeah. The inaugural World's Fittest Man. I like that.
Yeah.
So I wasn't sure if it was like, you know, how we were still refer to like previous presidents as president and you say their name, you know.
Exactly.
So
things to think about. Well, everyone's everyone's flexing a little bit here. For those that are only listening by audio. Eric, of course, has his degrees because he has to let everyone know he has a PhD plus a photo of him being a bodybuilder because he has to know that he's not just all brains, he's also bronze. We have Marcus, who just has the long hair, which automatically makes him feel like a brethren of mine. But then we're also joined by someone else. We're joined by James, and he's flexing with what can only be described as a copious amount of knowledge. And in fact, one of the books that he has in his background, which will be a talking point for myself and Eric, is a book on periodization. So it's interesting that he has that. If you notice that, Eric, top right, you think I don't see that? But I'm going to let Eric do the good intro on our CrossFit episode today for Iron Culture. The goal with Iron Culture is to unite the different lifting communities, provide that perspective and insight into those communities. And a great way that Eric explained this episode to me, which is true, is that in ways, CrossFit embodies more truly the origins of physical culture than some of the other sports, lifting sports that are out there today.
Yeah, and before any bodybuilders or powerlifters or weightlifters just gets all harumphy with that statement, and by harumphy, I mean, just to clarify, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, those who listen to our history episodes, they know from Dr. Dominic Moraes and Ben Pollock that the original bodybuilders, original powerlifters, they were doing calisthenics, hand balancing, weightlifting, the whole nine yards. And I think... it's actually pretty cool to see CrossFit create a culture around doing a lot of different things that includes weightlifting, because I think it's in many ways a throwback. So anyway, I'm honored to have two really cool guests today. So we have James Fitzgerald, like we said, the inaugural World's Fittest Man. He won in 07, the first year of the Games. Since then, he's become a coach of high-level CrossFitters and now like a coach of coaches, highly respected. James, welcome to the podcast.
Thanks. It's great to be here.
Glad to have you here. And we've also got Marcus Philly. Marcus, you've competed, I want to say, in, 2012 through 2016 in the individual and team as in the CrossFit Games. Is that right?
Yes. It started actually back in 2010, but that was that was my run.
That's awesome, man. So a really good spread of, arguably during a time period where the CrossFit Games changed a lot, too. Which I think is really impressive, because that means that you had to adapt as an athlete. You saw things change, and you're also a coach yourself at a high level. You guys both own facilities, own businesses, so you've got kind of the perspective as athletes coming up and then moving into the mentoring and coaching side. So and Marcus, you've got a really interesting personal story, which I connected with, just kind of. Which I'm sure we'll get into more with the rest of this podcast. So anyway, it's just an honor to have you both on. So thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you for having me. It's great to be here, guys.
Cool. So I think just because we don't have a whole lot of those involved in the CrossFit world listening, if you guys could take some time and give your own little personal introduction to give your personal flair of what it means to you to be you and how you relate to fitness, that would be awesome. And if we just want to start... James, with you, if you could tell us a little more about yourself.
Yeah, I was a young athlete, loved sports and disliked school, and then created an identity as a young kid, as an athlete, and then got an injury, and then recognized graciously that at a young age I couldn't connect to that athlete perspective anymore, and so went into a rough state of trying to figure out, you know, about being a number now and not this highlighting athlete. In that wonderful time, though, fell in love with conditioning that brought me back to realizing this aspect of fitness, and then wanted to learn all about it. So went into an academic route of that and soaked up as much as I could. Got out and started practicing it. This was late 90s, so people can get an idea as to fitness professionalism and fitness coaching back then. And basically was a whore to the fitness industry for, you know, over a decade. Did everything you can think of within that period of time. It was a game-changing opportunity, in my belief, at that period of time for fitness in general. And I was on that massive wave. And now bring up to today, I coach people, I coach coaches, I have an education system that helps people deliver fitness to the masses around the world.
That's OPEX, right?
Yep. Yeah.
Awesome.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Love it. So tell us a little more about your academic background. Like, what was your specific pathway before you got into training?
Yeah, it's a BPE honors with a minor in biology. It's a kinesiology program, but it was called physical education out of the Memorial University in Newfoundland. And I got to, figure out exactly where within there I wanted to stick my hat. And I was fortunate enough to be mentored by David Bame, who is one of the leading exercise physiologists in Canada, under Digby Sale and his counterparts in exercise physiology on the East Coast, and so fell in love with research and the science aspect of it, and did a dissertation on interplated twitch technique and muscle fatigue, which was just enough of a touch to recognize that I really love this scientific aspect of fitness.
Very cool. So you got to play with research a bit through the that's an honors dissertation for your bachelor's?
Yeah.
Very cool.
Awesome.
Just well, again, enough to realize how important it is.
Yeah. Yeah. Which honestly for a practitioner is a really big piece. So that's great. James, thank you for that. Marcus, let's hear a little bit more about your story, man. I've heard a bit about it on other podcasts, but I just found it really cool how you kind of had a crisis of a personality, and I won't tell the story for you, but I think it's a really cool story how you got into CrossFit. So if you could share that with us, that'd be awesome.
Yeah, absolutely. I think much like James, I was like an athlete was my identity growing up. Student athlete really was kind of this blend of, hey, Marcus is a great student, Marcus is a top tier athlete, played soccer all the way through college, and I actually had a chance to play Division I soccer at UC Berkeley. And in my college years, I was pre-med, biology degree, molecular biology, family of doctors that I kind of came from, and so I kind of had a sense I wanted to go into health sciences. I just connecting my athleticism and my love for movement and sport and like using my body as a vehicle to kind of better my own personal life, it lended itself well to this to this like idea of healthcare, and I was going to go into healthcare somehow, but the path of like the health and fitness professional and the fitness coach hadn't really been laid out for me by anybody yet, and this was like in 2004, 2005, 2006 when I was finishing up college. So the thought of I'll go to medical school, and I'll discover a new form of healthcare. I'll try and determine carve my own path in Western medicine was really what I wrote my admissions essays to medical school about. Was I'm going to own a facility someday where I'll be a doctor and I'll work alongside nutrition experts and exercise experts, and we'll basically care for people with kind of a holistic approach. This was an essay I wrote in 2007 to get into medical school. And so my college sports career sort of ended a little sooner than I'd liked, because I just realized I wasn't a top level athlete. I was going to ride the bench for 4 years, and I wanted to kind of put my passion towards other things. Mainly strength conditioning. I had gotten into collegiate strength conditioning, fell in love with the concept of I can train just as hard as I played the sports that I was playing before, and I can get a lot more personal fulfillment out of getting strong, muscular, lean, running fast, lifting heavier weights. So this was kind of the marriage of my fitness and then my academic studies. And I went to medical school at Ohio State University, and again, not really seeing like a path in traditional Western medicine ahead of me that I wanted to pursue. I didn't want to specialize in any one thing. And after the first year of medicine, I found myself pretty unhealthy, lost touch with my physical fitness the way I had come to love it. I was relatively depressed, and just headed down a path that just didn't feel right. I mean, the the Western medicine education system is brutal, and it didn't really leave a lot of room for being creative. It was like, oh, you want to do something that's outside the box? Like, good luck, you know, just try and trudge through the next 9 years of academic pursuit and see if you come out with any creative juices left. And at the same time, the CrossFit community was growing really fast. There were communities all over that were, I saw people coming to, you know, gyms to do conditioning, to talk about food, to talk about health and wellness. It was very attractive to me, and I was just like, God, I feel like that's where I need to be. I need to be on that side of the health and fitness world and less on the treating symptoms of disease with medicine. And so I took a leave of absence, really with no intention of going back to medical school, and I plugged myself into the CrossFit community as a coach, thinking, okay, this is going to be the change of my professional career, is I'm going to go into this avenue. And it was shortly after that that I realized that the CrossFit community, while it was this great energetic space and this amazing community, there was a huge lack of knowledge and education systems in place for me to learn as a health and fitness professional or coach. And I think it was like right then when I became aware of James and James's education system and OPEX, formerly OPT. And I kind of linked up with him early on to sort of help give me the tools and a platform from an education standpoint to become a professional in this industry. And then shortly after that, there was a competitive athletic career that kind of sprung up as a CrossFitter, which really happened. It didn't happen very intentionally. It was just I was good at some of the things that were going on, and I still had a passion and love for training and fitness. So I fell into that and learned a ton over the span of 7 years competing.
Awesome. I think it's really cool how you guys both started in academic routes and then found yourself in CrossFit. I think that probably speaks to why you're both well respected in your methods as coaches. And we'll get into that for sure. And you know, it's funny, Marcus, that you found that CrossFit at that time when you first got into it, there was a general lack of knowledge. I think some of the stereotypes that are still lingering among the strength and bodybuilding community, when we hear the word CrossFit, and you'll see those rolling of eyes or judgmental comments on social media, probably are outdated now in many circles in CrossFit. Like, I remember being surprised when I got my USAW weightlifting certification, I think back in 2011, at California Strength. More than half of the people who were attending it were CrossFit coaches. And it surprised me. And it was one of the times where I had to check my own biases, where I was like, hey, like, this is awesome. They're going to the same certification I am. They're reaching outside of their own circle. They are trying to better themselves. And I talked to like three different coaches. Two of them had master's degrees. And it was probably a good ego check on my part to be less judgmental and to kind of look outward. When do you think there was, I'll ask this to both of you, when do you guys think there was a large shift to where the education level in CrossFit started to upskill? And when was there a change towards being a lot more invested in becoming high-quality coaches? Or was it just a time thing?
I'll start with it. I think actually I would disagree with the perception. I think we have to define what CrossFit is in context, because I would say that simply because it's popular or that it looks like there's a lot more people out there in it, doesn't qualify it as being successful for proper movement and proper prescription and if that makes sense, in terms of knowledge of it. I think where we were talking about those two stories of Marcus and I, CrossFit as a sport is like years different. I don't even know how to describe it, of the continuum and the story.
Can you try just a little bit? Sorry, James, what you say? Because you're an OG. Yeah.
Well, yeah. I'll be very, you know, simple on it. And listen, this doesn't come from the background. I played all games in it, right? I was a facility owner of CrossFit. I participated in the sport. I coach, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And I also now am fighting the resistance around, you know, what people consider to be professional fitness coaching. So you need to know this is where it comes from, right? Yeah. So in the sport of CrossFit, you're trying to make all kinds of contractions aerobic. So you want to think of it as like, you know, bounding around a track and doing plyometrics. You have to make that sustainable, okay? Now, you don't have to be scientists to recognize that that's not healthy, right? That's not healthy. It's a very unnatural consequence, right? I would argue, as a separate topic, CrossFit is the most unnatural sport in terms of working against biology, right? And we don't want to go down that road, but that's one side, Omar, okay? So yeah. The sport side, it's prizes and points and pain and, like, go for it. You got to be really good at it. And then what you just discussed there, which I want, just what's on my disagreement in, is not that there's not a lot of great CrossFit coaches over there, but that's a totally different lane. So simply because there's 10,000 plus affiliates and that they have lots of education choices, we have to decide upon what we define as success for what that means over there, right? And that gets really, really gray, because there's a lot of personal trainers, a lot of bodybuilders, a lot of powerlifting, there's a lot of yoga instructors, a lot of cycling instructors that do just the same effect based upon our definition of success over there. Mm-hmm. So I would say, Eric, that based upon the timelines, and that's why I'm cheating on it, it looked like there was a lot more involvement and interest inside of it, but that does not mean that it made an impact in terms of great prescription at the trenches level in the box.
Awesome. So then let me have you help me ask a better question. Is when do you think, and do you think, or is it still working on it, that the in the trenches outcome of having better qualified coaches started to take hold? Or is CrossFit still lacking?
I won't throw CrossFit in there because okay. It's unfair to throw them under the bus in that. It was the tech and shit that happened in 2001, 2003 in all different areas, right? Mm-hmm. Economy changed, finances changed, education changed, and fitness changed. Yep. And what happened there was that everyone could become a coach because we lost this aspect of reality and fantasy in this online world, right? So you could do a weekend cert and that proliferated these micro gyms where, you know, the cause was all powerful, right? We're doing this for health and let's move it forward. Yet the prescription in the box at the trenches, right? Not just CrossFit, but any micro gym was yeah. someone who was handcuffed, right? To do this thing called intense fitness with no base of education, right? So they were, and anyone could do it, dude, right? And yeah. the reason why I get pissed at that, which you can probably sense it, is that at this point I had like 10 years of coaching and suffered like a motherfucker to build a business and how long it took to do that, to have someone take a weekend course to be compared to me.
Yeah.
Right? To be compared to me, right? And to have success in the gym, right? With having lots of members and people just doing crazy shit for 60 minutes, 8 hours a day, right? And so mm-hmm. that's where I would say, Eric, it's early 2000s where anyone could do it, and it proliferated this whole shitstorm of what is fitness and how you should do it, and et cetera, et cetera.
No, I think that's a really valuable perspective. And as someone who is slightly younger than you, and who I started personal training in 2004, I was kind of seeing the echoes of that had already started, and someone who's trying to pursue my education and do it right. And seeing many people who kind of went, oh, you don't really have to do it right, though, so why would I? Like, I can get this thing done without that level of effort or detail. And I think that that's a really good perspective, because that's something that any personal trainer, whether they have a strength bias, an aerobic bias, or a yoga bias, like you said, or what have you, can relate to, in that there are people who are doing the same profession but not taking it seriously. And unfortunately, in our field, that means hurting people and potentially putting people into a worse place than they were when they ever entered the gym, which I think is the biggest travesty of all.
Well, so I think the biggest travesty is not injury. I think the biggest travesty is that people get lost. So they do this yo-yo fitness program. That's what I think the travesty is. Because then you have no data on your injury, right? Because I think the injury route is not even worth talking about. I think what happens is you get 80% of people who just get shuffled in and out of programs, right?
Yep.
But who's gonna data that? Who's going to analyze that? You know what I'm saying? Like, no one's going to find all those people, right? Because they're just jumping around for the next two decades trying to find out what's best for them for fitness.
Absolutely. That's something I refer to as the transient fitness industry, to where so much of the fitness industry is based on short-term outcomes and quick changes, and the idea that there's always something better and new, that it never asks the person to move from the initial stages of change into actually committing to a lifestyle of fitness. They get bought in, not really, but by kind of the hype when they are still not convinced that this is something they should do. And then eventually, like you said, they drop off of fitness altogether.
Wait, but guys, we are going to talk about the Hollywood physique, right? Attaining the Hollywood body.
This is what this podcast is about.
But the Hollywood physique was only in three magazines you could pick up in the late 90s, right? But someone in 2019 gets 75 different versions of that in five mediums every day.
Yeah. That's very true.
That's the ultimate difference right there. So you can try hard, but you're going to have a hard time shifting people's behaviors based upon that for the long game, which is why, you know, indirectly why I like what you guys are doing, or what's the medium here? It's iron, right? That's the number one word in your piece. The iron never lies. There's reality in terms of strength, right? There's reality in resistance. That's what, and I think that's what brings Marcus into this picture too, is how does resistance play a role in this entire, you know, theme of fitness? How does it fix, you know, fucking 100,000 broken people, right? How does it align with people for longevity, right? That's what brings us together, is the iron of that. So just a shout out to the name, plus also how we got to that problem. And the iron may come back to fix everything.
I believe in the iron, personally. I mean,
We're part of the cult.
Yeah, absolutely. We are drinking the Kool-Aid and we'll never stop, except when we actually have to lift, and then we set it down between sets. So
okay, I just need Marcus to do it.
So Marcus, you got any thoughts on that whole discussion?
I mean, I go back to your original question, and I think you said something along the lines of, like, when did education or the coach, the CrossFit coach, start to become arm themselves with better tools? And I agree with everything that James said, and to also answer that more, I think, directly, it was just as the CrossFit culture grew and the competition amongst facilities grew, I think owners and coaches of these different facilities recognized that it wasn't enough to just go and attend a weekend seminar. If they were looking out for their best interests, of their own best interest, the interests of their clients, to have a future business, to continue to be successful, they recognize that, you know, 2 days of, you know, an in-person seminar wasn't going to suffice to separate them amongst the 10 different facilities that were right down the street from them. So they started to seek out, you know, other continuing education, seminars, online training tools. I think the best of the lot out there started to resonate with coaches like James, and see that the value in having an education system that really showed you how to coach individuals from many different aspects of fitness, not just exercise prescription or how to coach movement, but to look at people's nourishment, to consult with people, to understand their why behind their fitness pursuits. So I don't know, that might be a more direct answer to that question, that it's just like the competitive market just kind of forced everyone to say, oh shit, I don't actually know anything. I should actually try and learn some things so that I can do a better job, because people are walking out of my door saying that they're not getting what they need, and they're going to go down to the other place just, you know, literally a block away that's offering, you know, a similar service for $10 cheaper per month.
And I think, Eric, so for your users or for your listeners, Eric, they'll understand this, right? So you go to a weekend seminar for powerlifting, right? And you could go to 12 different people and you're going to learn some nuggets, right? If you go back to your crew, right, you can immediately implement and they can actually express the skills that you learned, right? So all these coaches went to advanced gymnastics seminars and weightlifting seminars, and none of it, I would say maybe 3% of everything that was learned, could actually be implemented back in the trenches, because all the consumers couldn't express what they were learning. So, you know what I'm saying? So you can see that if you go to do the education and you're just proposing to the public, I have all this education, but yet you look at the class, you're like, yeah, but you're just going around in a circle for 20 minutes. Do you know what I mean? It actually, yeah, it just creates, it just boggles my mind, you know, as to how that somehow caught hold. But of course it needed to be a part of the story and the narrative to keep people interested in the intensity.
Right. So while you're building your resume, the WAD is still the same back at your box.
And 90% of people can't express it. Right. They can't do it.
Yep.
Because I haven't built the base of fitness to even do what you've learned.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And you can lighten it up or make it somewhat, you know, shortened in range of motion or style, but they're still not getting the dose response that they actually need or should have.
Hmm. Interesting. So that's, I think, that's something I want to juxtapose a little bit. So what is occurring at the CrossFit, you know, box in your local town with the people who sign up and are motivated and want to get fit? And then what is occurring at the highest level, where people are actually training for the games? It's pretty different, but I don't know that most people know that. I think, this was another one of those eye-opening experiences for me. Ian Houghton, I think, James, you know, mutual friend, he was presenting at the Academy for Personal Training conference in Norway in 2015. It was a really cool first time I'd been to that part of the world. And he was sharing a survey that he did of, I believe, coaches of athletes, at least at the regional level. And something like between 50 to 60% of them were using periodization. And he was expressing how the concept of constantly varied or the perception of doing WADs on a daily basis was really not the norm for high-level athletes, and that they were actually having to, like the book behind you, maybe periodize their training in some way. So if you guys could both give us a perspective on what's the experience of the person who goes to the local CrossFit box, is trying to get in better shape, is participating there versus someone who is on the cusp of qualifying for games. What does the training, the mentality, and the whole experience look like, and how do those differ?
Okay, I'll do my best to just sort of generalize here. I mean, I owned a CrossFit facility for 5 years, and I worked in one for 3 years additionally to that. And over the course of those 8 years being in that space, I saw my facility change dramatically in the way that we tried to approach, you know, group design. And it was influenced a ton by my own experience as a competitive athlete. So I think in 2011 or 2012 was the first year I linked up with James as a coach. James coaching me and my teammates, and then subsequently he coached me as an individual athlete in the sport of CrossFit. Prior to that, I was following online training templates that James was putting out that kind of were for like a general avatar of like a competitive male CrossFit athlete, which I fit somewhat well. So I had been accumulating years and years of following periodized training for the competitive sport of fitness. And there were small things that I could learn from that. I mean, I didn't have a big strength conditioning education background to understand periodization, but I could learn from doing, which is what I did for all my years as an athlete, because it always had to tie back to me being a coach, was to recognize that, you know, having some consistent training, you know, doses within week to week progressions or over the course of months, even as an advanced athlete, was really beneficial to me, in that I could actually see, you know, progress every Monday. If I was doing a squat training cycle or a snatch training cycle, this was of value to me as just an athlete. And wanting to bring that back into our you know, our group fitness facility and not make it just about constant variance where every Monday we're doing something completely different that clients have no, there's no continuity from week to week over the course of months or quarters or half a year. So that started to transform because I as a coach and as an owner could see that there was like a serious flaw in this concept of just, you know, everybody's getting some random workout on a Monday, and it it didn't give the coaches an opportunity to really coach. They were just sort of managing, you know, an hour of group chaos. Whereas if the coaches were in every Monday, the Monday 9 a.m. coach was able to coach a similar movement pattern week after week after week that had subtle progressions to it for our clients, then they were actually having an opportunity to like learn new motor patterns and develop somewhat. It wasn't a perfect system by any means. That's why I actually left that model. But that was, I think, where a lot of, you know, the group fitness CrossFit gyms had started to move towards before I left the space. Still, the vast majority around the world are doing constantly varied high intensity workouts that don't have much rhyme or reason to what's being programmed. It's whatever looked cool on somebody's, you know, fitness blog or on Instagram channel, or a competitive workout that they saw at a competition that they scaled down for their clients in the gym. You know, when they talk about 10,000 CrossFit affiliates maybe worldwide, probably 80 to 85% fall into that category where they're still not following any form of periodization whatsoever. But at this stage in the game, anybody that's competing at a high level in the sport of fitness is most of the time being coached by an individual, like by a coach that has laid out a 6 to 12 month fitness plan for them that's helping them peak for these key qualification steps to get to bigger competitions, you know, sanctional events or worldwide level events too.
James, you got any other thoughts on that?
Yeah, I just wrote down a couple there. The Ian's point on the 50 to 60% of regionals for a periodized program, I've spent a lot more time on that for looking at programs and coaching programs or coaches of coaches programs, etc. And I would argue that it's a very high percentage actually go through periodized programs. It's just how you splice out the data and how you look inside of it. And the reason why I have discovered this is actually seeing the best who claim that they don't have periodized programs and watching them over a period of time. They have a self-organization or an internal governor and an opportunity to like regulate things appropriately, and which makes them significantly better than others. So to say that that's not periodized is actually not, because there is a point there where in a 15 minute workout they're gearing down, but you don't see them gear down, which is pacing. And if it is pacing and you're doing it 6 months out, because it's 6 months out, then that is periodization. That's called planning. So it actually does occur. I would posit it's 100% of competitors that periodize for the sport, because it has two massive different intentions based upon your question. At the gym level, most people, their intention coming in is for a sweat. They're on a sugar drip. They're looking for cortisol. They're looking for a serotonin dopamine response. Check off, you know, and now it's different today. If whether it's Instagram for one person, or whether it's a high five, or whether it's being feeling like they're part of a tribe with the tribalism concept over it, that's why people go and do it. For an athlete, it's volume. That's the number one difference. Marcus just spoke of it. He averaged, we detailed it, Marcus would get up to 12 to 16 hours per week. That was like including all forms of work. So you're talking like 3 to 5 hours per day, 6 days a week, okay? That's not health and fitness, folks. That's to make you do 40 chest to bar pull-ups, rest 2 minutes, and do it again. That's what that is. And that's nowhere near connected as to what you're gonna see in the gym. So the obvious difference is two different forms of intention. The intention in the gym is the sweat equity, and for the athletes, it was maximal physical expression. And that was done in the form of big change in volume. To the point on, you know, the constant variance thing, variance is only seen inside of the sport athletes for simple perturbations for metabolic increase, or what you guys would talk about in conjugate or changes in resistance to improve people's strength, right? So we use variance inside of those, but what are things that have stood the test of time? We still have aerobic and strength progressions that are periodized, and people simply still go through that manner. And if they don't know that it's periodized, that doesn't make it not periodized. You know my point? Right? If they're like, oh no, this is not periodized, well, let me watch you train.
If they're not aware that they're doing periodization, but they still do periodization, it's periodization.
Exactly.
Right.
Let me ask a question for you guys then, where over the last decade, CrossFit and Ways has changed. What would you say is the appeal for individuals entering it, where you said, you talked just right then and there, James, about sweat equity, or for people, the Instagramification of fitness, where people do it for various reasons. What is the appeal then, and has that appeal changed? Why do people decide to do CrossFit then, from your experience, versus other modalities of training?
Well, I'd say a couple of years ago, it was more around maximal expression still. And because there's been some massive shifts in the sport over the past 6 months to a year, it's really shaken a whole lot of people up, because they've had to question this intent going forward.
Right.
So I think you actually created a verb that I stuck in my head, Instagramification. I didn't know that that was actually a word, but I'm going to be using that now. Thank you, Omar. But that's what a lot of people got really hurt over, is that they saw this lack of open to regionals like opportunity, which was like tens of thousands of raving fans of the sport that now were pulled away. And it doesn't mean they don't still have, you know, opportunities to still do weekend competitions, but a lot of people felt lost. And so they have to now sit back and go, yeah, why am I doing this thing?
In the first place,
Why am I doing this thing? And if I can't, like, get on Instagram and show that I'm at the regionals, why would I do this? And
right.
That's a good question. That's a good question. So it has shifted. And I'm an old man in it, right? So you got to remember.
OG.
I started this when no one really knew what you were doing, right? I would just put my times on .com, and we were doing it in a garage, workouts per day, right? And then no one believed me, and hence why I started YouTube on the process, because no one believed me that I was doing it. So I was like, well, here, you know? And so you have to understand my biases in it too. I'm old to this, so.
Yeah. Mm. There's some really interesting things that have been said that I want to touch on. For one, the difference, I think, in strength conditioning as a whole, and we see this in different elements of barbell programming, there is sometimes the mistaken identity of randomization as variation, and they're definitely not the same. And it sounds like Marcus, like you were saying, and then James, you commented on, like, there's a good chunk of people in CrossFit trainers, like you said, 80-85% of the trainers at boxes who don't have that distinction down, that they're not using variation as a tool, as an element of periodization. They're using it to randomize training. I think that's something that is shared across all aspects of fitness. And something when I used to teach personal trainers, and I still do in some ways, I would try to express to them, hey, your job is not to be, as much as your client may even ask for it, to be a one-on-one group X instructor, to where they just come in and you work them out and they feel great and they leave. That's fine. You want them to feel that way, but you also need to have some kind of connected, you know, training, that continuity and progress and progression. And I think it's an unfair characterization to say that's just an element of CrossFit. It sounds like that's an element of fitness in general when an uninformed coach is training. So I think that's a cool thing I wanted to point out. And then the other thing that was said that I thought was interesting was specifically the point you made, James, about and I'm losing my thread here, about how shit. What was I? Yes, thank you. You read my mind. This is beautiful. Yes, the periodization. How just because someone is not aware that they're periodizing doesn't mean that they aren't, and how some of the best athletes do autoregulation, which was the whole focus of my study over the last few years, is autoregulating. And it's essentially the difference between a top-down periodization or almost bottom-up. And I have seen the same thing among high-level bodybuilders, powerlifters, weightlifters who don't quote-unquote periodize. But if you watch them, they fall into these natural patterns, and they seem to be very self-aware and also able to be objective about their, in a very natural kind of intuitive way, about what their capacities are, when they should push, when they should pull back, and they can string that together to then, you know, peak and be effective and succeed. So I think that that's almost something like it's a, I would say it's a quality of many natural athletes. And I don't know if that's an observation that you guys have both had, but it certainly is of mine. I've seen that be the case in both bodybuilding and strength sports.
I actually, something just came to mind when you were saying that, and that is, I think that not only did I have good coaching that laid out a structure that was periodized for my year, but I was also quite good at auto-regulating as the season kind of, you know, the window of time leading into competition got narrower and narrower. And one of the reasons why I think I had to step back from competing after 2016 was, aside from family obligations and having, you know, children, was just that the timeline of the competitive season, I couldn't keep up with it. You know, my auto-regulation was telling me, it's not time to go, but the calendar said it was time to compete. And I was just like, shit, I don't feel up for it. I can't turn into that extra gear that I need to level up intensity prior to, you know, the different stages of competition. And this was in part due to the fact that, which is now becoming even more complicated in the sport of CrossFit, but at the time when I was wrapping up my run of competitive, you know, CrossFit, was CrossFit Open, CrossFit Regionals, CrossFit Games, and then we sprinkled in this other sport called Grid, which was a team functional fitness deal, which was really high speed and like highest expression of intensity that I was doing throughout a year. And all of it just was happening too frequently for me to just keep up. And so even though I took a step back for, you know, the reasons of having a family, like there were signs within myself that I could just tell. It was like, it was time to compete in the 2017 Open. And I was just like, I don't think I can't level up right now. You know, it's January. I'm supposed to be in that mode where things are starting to click. And it just wasn't working. So I got tired from the schedule of CrossFit, which now is even, you know, for those people that are trying, that are in that upper echelon of athlete who maybe don't have great guidance, there are that many more qualification steps or opportunities to try and qualify for big events happening almost every other week, it seems, for about a 4 to 6 month period of the year. And I think a lot of people who, even, you know, even if they have good auto regulation, are gonna get pretty burnt by that very quickly.
And the sport is young. We got to remember that, right? We're not 50 years into this thing, so there's still lots to learn. But the talent level is getting so high up at the top, we can learn from things and use those people as a beacon, right? Mm-hmm. So there's enough of that now, especially for me. You know, I'm one of a few that sit back in a room and analyze this shit a lot. So we can start seeing those things, right? It should be mentioned, though, in Mark's story, and this what made him a great athlete that goes unspoken, is his ability to grow through that regulation, right? Because he had to have, well, I'm going to put words in his mouth, but this is how I saw it. Him having a program or having someone give him a program allowed him to be more vulnerable in trusting his abilities to do what he needed to do. Because Marcus is analytical or creates logic around, oh, what do I have to do there in that task? Oh, that? And he would think about it, right? So what a coach offered him was this ability to build up so much confidence. What we, you know, in the back end, Eric called this regulation opportunity, right? But what the base was that, which is what we're trying to learn here, the base of it was resilience, right? The human has to have great resilience. They got to have great basic lifestyle guidelines, which Marcus was like the poster boy for that, right? Water, sunshine, flowing hair. There's a bunch of other things. The hair is not included in lifestyle guidelines, but he.
I feel like it should be.
Sure helps with marketing.
We could maybe add to that, except I have to be a leader of that, so that would be a problem. But these things people forget, they leave those things on the table, and they forget that Marcus got to this point, I think, as an athlete, because he had a coach who worked with him to allow him to just be like, hey, dude, don't think about this. Make it an auto-regulatory system, right? Just trust in your system to kind of give you feedback on making that happen. And I think that's what got him actually to the, like, let's call it, levels of Marcus in the sport. He was able to overcome those the feedback loop of the regulation, right? Where he just shut it off, was like, I'm not listening anymore. And that's what put him to high max physical potential, if that makes sense.
Oh, it really
does make sense. Which the other side of that, the downfall, is you have a serious health consequence or some like wake-up calls after that, right? And but that's what max physical expression is. To get to max physical expression, you have to stop the feedback loops, right? You have to err on the side of death and sickness, and you got to go to that route, right? And that's why, as I say, to go after these things, which are so unnatural in our sport, it only leads one path.
Yeah, that's such a... I don't think most people understand that truly stark contrast between two things that are both CrossFit. Pushing yourself to the highest level of your own physical potential as a competitor, an athlete, versus the experience of being a member of a local CrossFit gym or box. And I think there's actually a lot of value in both. One of the things that I've been continually impressed with in the CrossFit community is that there's a lot of uptake among people who join CrossFit gyms. It's gotten a lot more people into fitness. And I think it's for very obvious reasons. Like, we have solid research and a solid background knowing that people, when they exercise together, they do better. They're more consistent. They're more likely to stay in the gym. People with exercise partners or who join group classes typically stick with it longer, get better results. Also, the culture around CrossFit is one where you're given respect so long as you work hard. You know, there is a kind of, at least from an outsider's perspective, there is a culture of rewarding hard work at your level, whatever that might be, which I think is great. It's not purely on something external or fixing what is broken. You know, you guys have pointed out many things that are imperfect about it, but if I kind of look at the silverest of linings, those aspects of the kind of the community aspect of CrossFit I really like. And I think also it has a lot more, sometimes to a detriment, but there is a positive element as well, a lot more variety, which keeps the average person who wants fitness to be fun, whether they realize it or not, you know, they see it as a workout and they have to make themselves go. When it feels like play, that element of play and enjoyment, I think is really important to keep people in the gym as well. So all of that stuff, I think, doesn't get enough recognition in the kind of the community CrossFit side of it, which I'll call it that. And then...
I'd agree with the...
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah, please do.
I would agree with the variety position. There's no doubt, right, that what that offered is variety. And I don't want to put specifically CrossFit in here. I'm just going to put any micro gym. But I'd like to question if it actually has benefited. Right. Mm-hmm. So your comment was, I think it has benefited a whole bunch of different things. Well, you got to define success. So if you define success as a turnstile, a 50% retention in micro gyms, you know, is that successful? So I think we need to define that. F45, you know, there's $1 billion for Orange Theory now in their value. Yoga, Women's Only Fitness did this, YMCA. Like, we got to define what success means. And the reason why I always get like hairs on my neck when we say that, it's got nothing to do with the brand, right? It's got nothing to do with it. It's got to do a lot with the whole definition of success in fitness. And the definition of success in fitness is that someone's going to reach autonomy and figure out how the fucking to do this fitness thing forever. So if that's your definition, all of those things failed. All of them. And so simply due to populism, or what looks like is, you know, more things happening, Eric, I don't think that defines success. I'm sorry to hit on it, but and the reason why, like, I got a catch on that is because I know how hard it is to try to change the cultural perspective on that intention, right? And how to, like, get people bought into this program for a long period of time. And essentially what I do, which is, you know, my mantra is to stop killing fitness coaches. And that those other models you just talked about there, that kills all of them. All of them.
No, I like that perspective, and I like if you're trying to bring my happy bubble back to earth. I think that's a good thing, because if we want to make real change, we have to acknowledge the weaknesses of the elephant in the room. Really, I think for me, what I see success as on an individual level, which then of course translates to society, would be someone who adopts a lifestyle of fitness and who falls in love with movement. And it makes them a better person in terms of health and mind. And I think when you incorporate the elements of community and you train together and it's fun, there's a greater likelihood of that. And I know that when I was a personal trainer in my younger days and I was probably too biased towards, say, bodybuilding or powerlifting, I don't think I was giving many of my clients a large enough slice of fitness life, if you will, to perhaps ping on what might really motivate them to stick with it. You know, if they didn't like training like a bodybuilder or a powerlifter, I had nothing else for them. And, you know, then they might quit lifting or quit training or quit fitness in general and think, well, you know, it just wasn't for me, when they might have needed to play like intramural soccer or something like that. But that they weren't going to get that from me. And I think there's probably a greater chance of being exposed to more of the smorgasbord, if you will, being involved in CrossFit.
Yeah, that doesn't make not having all the tools the right program.
I totally agree. Yeah, I think
otherwise we're getting into like, whoa, we got to do this over here. I think it goes way back to the intention of exercise.
Yeah.
So, you know, if we can pull us all together, or if that's what we've decided to, bodybuilding, ironically, can't be sexy. You can try to sexy that up as much as you want, but that's essentially what's going to, you know, allow people to connect to some form of working against resistance with variability that is actually connected to longevity. Because in your point, I do agree. Getting together with people, sweating, creating responsibility for their fitness, getting aha moments, great. One thing you didn't use the word longevity. So if you're going to be inside of a program, you need to say, if you're a 25-year-old and if you're not connected to intention on fitness is going to make you do this until you're 75, we need to question the program, right? Otherwise, we're just in this little dance with a bunch of 25-year-olds until they get to 35 and recognize, oh, probably I should be consistent in this now. You know what I'm saying? But it's just that, absolutely, you know, everyone sees it differently. So I would say you did a lot of service to people by offering specific linear design of resistance, and there's so much beauty inside that. I think that's what Marcus is playing with now. It's like how to create variance inside of that resistance that can be fun, right? That can be enjoyable, but is still in that bucket of resistance. So it's what the variability looks like. And I just want to be careful of that, because I think you did a lot of people service, and you may not need to do the smorgasbord. It's just you may need to use the tools you had in place and use them differently to keep people involved in fitness.
You brought me down and you built me up, and I feel good afterwards.
It's called the sandwich compliment. It's like, I'm going to say something. You did this positive. Here's what I think, and then we're going to bring it back.
We're not going there, but I would ask your users to ask those questions, right? Why are you doing exercise, right? Why is anyone doing exercise, right? If we don't talk about that puppy...
Training for the apocalypse.
It's like we're just here talking on a phone on Skype and exercise, that's all great. So we got to talk about why we're doing it, right? And if we get down to that intention for Gen Pop, the thing, if you strip it down, what's going to be in the end is the fucking dumbbell, right? That's what's going to be left in the end. What's that one thing that will like set the tone for everything? Immune system improvements, confidence, relative strength. Like I could go on, right? It's not going to be the smorgasbord. It's not going to be fucking intervals of intense dynamic shit, right? It's not going to be that.
I love
and
it.
And if you want to argue like, whoa, you know, high intensity fucking showed fucking 6 weeks. It's like, yeah, but will they do that for the next 50 years?
Yep.
I think one of the problems probably Eric experienced that I did myself being a trainer for a while and just seeing how individuals work. You spoke, James, about the autonomy issue of how gyms are set up in general to have the client depend upon the trainer to give a top-down approach and then not give a framework for them to understand, first off, obviously, what their true intentions are, where I think people enter the gym thinking they have an intention of why they want to go to the gym, but not really getting to the core of that. But then, to a greater extent, learning about their own fitness and how to accomplish their own goals so they could leave after a while having that coaching and then be an autonomous individual. And I think that might be part of the appeal behind, from my perspective, I do some of that powerlifting. Why powerlifting has become popular is that there's a low level of entry of learning overall, like compared to other, let's say, compared to weightlifting as an example, where weightlifting is far more technical, other modalities. You after a while, as long as you do know the basics of programming, you can program on your own. And I have seen individuals, I go to a gym where the owner is 55 years old, he's been competing in powerlifting for 25 years, and there are numerous members who are in their 40s, 50s, and 60s that do, I'll just say, some sort of barbell resistance movement training program that has maybe some form of periodization or greater structure to it, where they're trying to improve themselves. And I think every person probably has to figure out what that looks like, but maybe it partially explains when you talk about autonomy of the individual towards a specific goal. Maybe partially that's why powerlifting, because it's easier in ways to comprehend, and there's that objective, I'm improving, here's what I need to do, and you see that feedback loop, why it has taken off.
Yeah, and which is why bodybuilding was, all ironically, the only thing we had to work with in the 90s, yeah. And that which got every bit of success for body, yeah, transformation, immune system function, decreased cortisol in the day, better sleep, better vitality, you name it. One tool, right? So what is powerlifting? It's just multi-joint bodybuilding. I just slap it into one area. It's called resistance, absolute strength training.
Yeah.
So if you put that all into fashion and you create some idea around it, some of the things that the powerlifting world, or I would call it the resistance world, is going to have to contend with is the intention around what's inside of the resistance. Because we're so connected to the 1RM, that needs to be moved aside, right? Mm-hmm. It needs to be, people need to recognize that overcoming resistance every day in multiple forms should be the goal. And it will naturally lead to an increase in maximum potential through resistance, not through gaining a 1RM, right? Because that makes a lot of people sad when they realize, like at my age, that you won't get stronger for the next 30 years.
Right.
So there's going to come a time where it's like, well, why am I doing this?
Sure. Right?
So you got to have that built in from the first part, and the young whippersnappers will get stronger. It doesn't matter. And then over time, though, they'll recognize this mastery inside of resistance is still just trying to overcome it and resist entropy forever.
Yeah, which is inevitable. The entropy is inevitable, so it's how do we resist it, right? Not to get Eric too dark, but just
that's pretty nihilistic if you dig there. Yeah.
Well, the concept, I think, James, I understand and dig what you're saying, where for some athletes, they get in that loop where, you know, they rise in their 20s and their 30s, they get stronger, they're breaking all-time numbers, but then at some inevitable point, either age or a variety of different factors, they will have reached their peak whether they know it or not. And after that point, where do you go and what's the function of this training if you're not pursuing your one rep max and they have almost an identity crisis, right? Because they internally are starting to recognize, I'll never be stronger than I was before. And we have, I think it ties into part of fitness or part of the side, I can only speak from the powerlifting side and seeing people live. There's a lot of that rugged individualism where, you know, we can always be better. You can always improve. It's like, well, at some point, well, wait a second here. It's like, you know, you're 45. You're 45 years old. Your hormones aren't what they used to be. Your joints aren't what they used to be. You know, there's a whole host of factors at play here. It's like, you might not hit a new one rep max. What are you going to do now?
Yeah, well, we see it in aerobic measures, right? From the age groupers from 38 to like 48, yeah, they still think they have a chance, right?
Yeah.
But it's because of the skill inside of the cardiovascular adaptations, people can still get better in those ages.
Yeah.
So why do a lot of people move out of that resistance mid-30s to like aerobic long shit?
Sure.
Because they can still have the athlete inside capability.
Yeah.
So mm-hmm. I'm actually just pointing this out because I think Eric down the road will compete in Ironman. Maybe like 10 years down the road. I'll just lay that out now.
All right. You're calling
I'll just
it
lay
out.
Wow.
You can take, James, please take Instagramification. We're going to take from you 10 years down the road.
This should be the tag. Yeah. This should be the tag for the show.
Yeah.
People be interested to see what's going on inside.
Hashtag 2029 Helms Ironman. I like that. I'm open to that possibility, but I don't think my future self will do it. But I'll be happy to be surprised.
We'll see.
You called it here. I like it.
We'll see when that free tea just is not the level that it used to be.
Absolutely. You know, I think this is something that I often say that as a coach, I will use the athlete mentality to get in the door to discuss bigger picture life lessons. You know, so for example, the cold reality is that we won't be better eventually, you know, in an objective way. If we're looking at it from the lens of being a powerlifter, improving 1RMs, or being on stage as a bodybuilder, looking better than the last time you competed. And however, you can find ways to be better depending on how you frame better. So that might be the competitive bodybuilder who has better life balance while still dieting down to incredibly lean levels, or the power lifter who's able to make better decisions on the platform, better attempt selection, and manage their arousal and have a better meet, even if the objective capacity on that day is not the same level. And I think you know, when I work with athletes across multiple years, and in which, you know, I've only been coaching long enough to just getting to start to do that, having athletes who started as juniors and are now competing in their 30s, the really cool part is starting with them being overly focused on winning and then getting them to focus on just being better than themselves and that result in winning, and then eventually getting them to be focused on the process and enjoying the resistance, like you said, and finding meaning and value in that, primarily, while, you know, self-improvement or winning are kind of these side effects. And I think that's what really keeps people in the sport or in fitness in general. So, James, I totally agree with what you're saying. I think finding that deeper meaning from lifting, from resistance, I think is probably a better, more all-encompassing term, is really important. And the historical roots they do all go back to bodybuilding, interestingly enough, and arguably some of the circus strongman stuff. But that wasn't all necessarily 1RM. It was just displays of what you could do through the iron, which I think is really cool. Marcus, I wanted to bring you into this. You've started incorporating more elements of bodybuilding with kind of your more recent philosophies. Can you tell us a little more about what you call functional bodybuilding?
Yeah. I was early, I don't know, maybe about 5 or 6 minutes ago in the conversation, I was kind of smirking because I just went through, I want to look at the last 10 years of my life were kind of this entire continuum that James has described. It was like, I did bodybuilding in college. Like, I got into some strength and conditioning through collegiate, you know, Division I strength conditioning coaches for my soccer team. But ultimately, I just fell in love with, you know, Pollockin, you know, bodybuilding splits. And I was doing that in college with a buddy, getting, you know, muscular, lean, feeling the best I'd ever felt in my life. And then got kind of this little bit of a connection to this idea of I could improve my performance in something called CrossFit, or like CrossFit got introduced to me. It was fun, it was different, and it challenged me in new ways, which I was looking for at the time. But suddenly there was a shift that happened to, like, I need to get better at something physical, and here's this sport that allows me to measure a bunch of stuff, or at least measure it against other people. So for years, I got away from this, I'm training to look good, feel better, sleep better, have confidence, to I'm dedicating all of my energy and time to improving performance metrics through this 24/7 lifestyle of being a competitive athlete. And over the course of 7 years of competing, it took this toll where I realized, like, the only way I could continue to get better in the sport was to devote and dedicate even more time and quiet the other things in my life and simplify even more and more and more. And then as the competition got more and more competitive, you know, the demands on my body, and just at 31, I think was the last year I competed, were getting relatively high. So it all kind of culminated in this moment where I finished the 2016 competitive season with some great results, but having this, like, sharp decline in my health afterwards, feeling just I don't know, people can resonate with the term burnt out, but I was really burnt mm-hmm. out. And I just desperately wanted, I mean, here I was already committed to a career in health and fitness, and I'm showing up to the gym to coach clients, and I'm getting online to write training programs, and I'm just like, fuck, I don't even feel good in myself. How am I going to inspire somebody to, you know, help inspire others to be their best self through health and fitness? And I kind of was like drawn back to sort of many of the things that I did. You know, I'm like having a flashback to 10 years before that. I was like, man, I used to get after it. I used to wake up excited to work out and go and just do some, you know, supersets and eat a good diet and ride my bike on the weekends and, you know, go to the track and run with my buddy. And I felt good, looked good. And I was on, like, you know, I was on the rise.
You're like, what the hell happened?
What the fuck happened? I'm the 12th fittest guy in the world. I feel like I can't even walk up a set of stairs right now. And, you know, how far have I fallen, you know, climbed and fallen? And fortunately, I was, you know, still being supported by one of the coaches down at OPEX and James indirectly, and you know, they recognized the place that I was at physically, and so to just build me back up as an individual, what did the training look like for me? It was to just basically return to bodybuilding principles. And bodybuilding demanded a new look to it for me because of everything I had experienced for the past 8 years. I mean, I knew how to snatch. I could do muscle ups. I could do handstand push ups. I was, I had an aerobic system that was developed pretty well. All things that I enjoyed doing. And it's like, how did bodybuilding and those and some of those elements fit together for the level of athlete that I was? And that's sort of where my training that was being designed by my coach, it started to take this look and feel of bodybuilding with functional fitness, you know, in quotes, functional fitness. So I started just hashtagging it as functional bodybuilding on social media. And I think a huge population of people out there resonated with it because they were like, I got into CrossFit by way of bodybuilding. You know, I was kind of a gym rat that decided they wanted to try out CrossFit, and I kind of missed doing some isolation, some curls, some, you know, slow concentric, eccentric contractions. But I also don't want to stop swinging kettlebells and maybe jumping on a box and maybe doing some kipping gymnastics. And so just sort of kind of playing with this blend of those two worlds, thinking about what's got to make up the majority of a training, you know, of most Gen Pop training programs is just basic resistance training with some aerobic work as well. And how do we give that a modern, updated look? Not because bodybuilding doesn't work, but because I think maybe to one of your points, Eric, was like, there's just maybe not enough variety within bodybuilding to keep people engaged for a long enough time to really embrace it for life. So those have just been some of the questions I've been asking over the last like 3 years since I did my last CrossFit Games and had a baby, and have been thinking a little bit about how my training needs to look and what's working for the clientele that I have coming into my facility, and then the people that are connecting with me on social media from all over the world who are most excited about this concept of functional bodybuilding that I post about, less excited about me doing, you know, snatches and muscle ups fast.
I think that's really interesting because it has some historical circularity to it. And what I mean by that is that through the fracturing of all the different disparate tribes, in quotes, of kind of the lifting community, each one has gotten a little further away from their originally intended purpose. So if we take bodybuilding back to physical culture, it was, hey, we're displaying the results, the visual results of our training that was focused on making ourselves healthier, stronger, more empowered in a broad sense. And our bodies are meant to be these representations of the holistic development of the human. And then as bodybuilding became its own thing, and Olympic weightlifting split, and as powerlifting split, and then bodybuilding got very, very more and more focused on no function at all form. And through the Weider days, and it became eventually just a pure physique competition. And, you know, with drugs, training systems, and nutrition, all wholly focused on just how can I make myself look, it got away from any kind of functionality. And, you know, you'll hear bodybuilders say things like, I have no interest in health. I'm just trying to look a certain way. And I'm not knocking that per se. But I think, again, going back to your point, James, about what are people going to be doing when they're 50, 60, 70, and what's going to remain in that room, it's going to be a dumbbell. I think the resistance aspect is that piece that needs to be continuous throughout. However, just because the way bodybuilders train is with these basic movements and a list of 10 per muscle group, or the way powerlifters train with, you know, the bench, squat, deadlift, and assistance exercises, doesn't mean we can't go all the way full circle back and look at what was done in the physical culture days that was globally representative of kind of building the body and bodybuilding in a more meta sense. And it sounds like that's what you're doing. And in many ways, it's seen as a new thing. Like, oh my God, how do you combine CrossFit and bodybuilding, when in fact, I think it's actually getting a lot closer to the roots of where it started, which is really cool.
Yeah, well, I said it. He's sexier. That's basically, and he's got more creative ideas, but and a bunch of other things. But in 2008, I was asked that in a public forum of these gathering of the rock stars in CrossFit at the time, which was a big falling out of multiple different things. And I was asked that very clearly. You know, the powers that be went inside the system were like, oh, well, if you're going to train people to be really good at CrossFit, OPT, if you know all, this is the tone of the question, right? If you know all these things, what do you think is going to be the answer to help all these people? And I said, bodybuilding for like years and years. That's what's going to help people. And that was like, I didn't even plan for that answer, but I had known everyone that have gained success within the sport all had a base of absolute strength training. Right, all had a base of lots of contractions. So if you want to make all that shit aerobic and dynamic and sustainable, you need to have a base support of tendon strength and muscle belly strength and head to toe contractions, right? And that's essentially, this is the beautiful side of this, fellas, is that Marcus is attracting so many people in the sport, and they're all group fitness, well, not a lot, I shouldn't say that. A lot of them are group fitness instructors who on the break between their classes are doing functional bodybuilding.
Of course.
This is the greatest thing ever, because they are setting the tone inside the gym, which is a broken model, that they're going to have to somehow circumvent this to put it out to the masses in a way that's going to be effective. Yet what they have on their door is the sugar drip, cortisol punch, high intensity pieces.
Okay, so
the beautiful thing around this is the way that it's coming back to sting them is 11 years later of what I predicted, because I saw it, right? I just saw it in shape and form, right? I have all these people who were only doing bodybuilding, and what I had to work with, they had no fucking business doing snatch, clean, jerk, or dynamic contractions. Then they were like, oh, James, you find this CrossFit thing great? Let's be a part of it. And then they started to move through it okay, right? Then you had this other generation of people who came on, no previous background, just using bands and doing dynamic activity, going, I want to be good too. And I'm like, no, you need 5 years of bodybuilding. And they're like, yeah. No, I need to go do that dynamic shit right now, right? And I took down a note here just so people don't think that Marcus is just like playing, right? This guy could make a snatch at 110 kilos every 2 kilos at a single up to 130, or well, below or above, depending. And it would look just like the first rep. So in just case people are thinking, oh, CrossFitter, he's not that strong. Yeah. No, you know, he would make 130 kilos look like it was fucking a PVC pipe, right? Yeah. So There is strength inside of his argument from proof of concept too, right?
Yeah.
Just so people don't think that we're just like flailing and jumping around.
No, I already have the movie analogy. If myself and Eric are Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid, I feel that you two guys, of course, I feel that you, James, are Morpheus and Marcus is perhaps Neo, and CrossFit is the Matrix. And so you're changing it from the inside out. And there's resistance by certain individuals, certain parties with a vested interest in the way things are. But you see a bigger picture, a greater picture of what it means, what fitness means as a whole.
You're like, Push yeah, Neo you're in like, the Sundex and the Sundance Matrix. I love it. Yeah.
No, you're 100%. I see that. I like that you think. And so now that I know those books, James, weren't just props for this conversation, they're actually things that you've read, digested, internalized, and now with the things that you say, I think we've expanded the conversation. We've had notes, myself and Eric, and we talked before doing this episode, you know, and us being more on the outside trying to learn and get a greater perspective, it's been very cool, because my introduction to CrossFit actually was maybe a little bit earlier than I think you said. There's that first generation, then the next generation that came after James that just wanted to participate. Yeah,
there was four of them.
So 2007 was my first where I saw someone do it, where he was a former wrestler.
That was the end of the first generation.
Okay. Okay.
That was when it ended. The day after the games is when that first generation ended.
Okay. And what is that first generation? Just before I go on, if you say the four phases, what are they?
The originals. Yeah. The originals. And then from the games, it spawned this new interest of those people that were interested in fitness.
Yeah.
Saw this as more than just going to a gym to work out. So you had the garage gym element, and then you had the micro gym element.
Yeah.
And then when it went to the games, so that was the second generation. Then when it went to the games in Carson, 2010 up, it created a third generation. And that was the Instagramification and media push on its popularity on a global scale.
Right.
And just 6 months ago, you've got the fourth generation,
okay,
which is a shift in intent of the sport participation, because now it's kind of like up in the air. Like, how do I create a future in this as a coach and an athlete, which is a good one. Yeah. It's a good place to be, especially where, you know, I would like to move the sport towards an Olympic ideal.
Oh, really? Where it eventually would participate in the Olympics?
Yes. 2028 for LA is the goal.
Now, here's a question. How do you see that happening? I ask because from the powerlifting side, they've met major resistance. The USAPL and the IPF, it's called, the International Powerlifting Federation, has tried and lobbied to participate in the Olympics for probably the last 15 years. WADA testing, all those, trying to be compliant. How do you see that breaking down then, just to talk about that?
I don't want to convolute this whole talk on it, but it's a lengthy story.
Okay.
It's obviously a big hill to climb.
Yep.
But it's unfair to use parallels of different sports and their adversities at a climbing.
Yep.
Because if skateboarding or dancing can get there, functional fitness can get there.
Yep.
But we just gotta talk to the right people in Switzerland. We gotta sign off all the shit that's necessary for governing bodies.
Yep.
We have all the committees built. We've got up to 30 plus registered governing bodies now, and I don't know what powerlifting's like downfall was in checking off all the boxes, but you got to have governance.
Yeah.
And so we have initial governance, and we're building, and that's our goal.
Yeah. I mean, if the equestrian pursuits are still in the Olympics, as I understand, like some of the sports activity, when they removed, I think they removed wrestling. Did they remove it for? I'm like, come on, when you name it, that's like saying powerlifting, and now we're going to measure without respect to power or absolute strength. Like, it's completely contrary to the original intention. But anyways, Eric.
Well, Omar, I think you were going to talk about your experience within 2007.
Yeah. So I was going to say that it's been interesting to see some of that evolution, because the intention behind the lifting, where this is someone that's committed forever, you know, to lifting. You just know those individuals where he's still lifting to this day. He was looking for something new to do, where he had a wrestling career, and he entered and tried to do CrossFit. But I remember it was, I think, in the early days of programming or organizing, there's maybe a WOD, right? The workout of the day and the true intention. But he had a card deck, the most vivid memory I have. I was doing, you know, just my squats, and he had a card deck, and he would throw. He was actually the manager at the gym that I trained at, which was a big box gym. So just a big corporate gym, think like a 24-hour fitness, right? And he's the manager, but he's having this big turn of events where no longer is he advocating, you know, just doing arm curls or whatnot. He's throwing down cards onto the ground, and it's like a 10, and then he's running to do, you know, 10 repetitions of this and that. And I was trying to ask him at the time, because he was my manager, I'm like, can you explain what you're doing? And he tried and I said, but so now it's completely randomized, as I understood it. We're trying with an intention, pursuing a specific goal. How the random variability, like, what does that do? And he was trying to explain it to me, but I remember just leaving confused and thinking, like, I don't know what's going on here. But I just remember the cards being thrown down, like he's just like, it's game time, cue Rambo music, and he's participating. And then after that, I didn't see him. He actually left, as you said, the micro box. He left the big box and then joined a micro box. And that was my first just impression of it. And then over time, getting actually into the online fitness space has been more positive, where I see various people talking about things when Eric said about a periodization or just different concepts and what that means. But it's like anything else when, you know, you take a look also at the origins of even weightlifting and a training where the full press was in there for a while, then it was removed, or how people approach it, anything that's entirely new. And I think there's that loss of fidelity of information, perhaps from him just joining and trying to do it, and then maybe what he should be doing, where he's just, you know, he's not grasping at straws, but he's trying to figure it out. And so he doesn't quite know what's going on. And then I'm asking him, and he's not quite explaining it. So I'm like, all right. I'm back away slowly as you're throwing cards down.
Yeah.
That was every conversation from 2008 to 2012. Well, what's CrossFit? Oh, it's this. And but he said it was different, and everyone had a different way of describing it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that really does speak to the youth of the sport, and I think it's I think that might be a good segue where we maybe could touch on some of the things you were just mentioning, James, of where do we see the future of CrossFit going? We're coming into this fourth generation.
Yeah.
I think we alluded to it. We didn't actually speak to it. CrossFit, the organization of the sport, has just changed a bit, how you actually go to the games. If maybe you could walk us through what that big organizational change has been, and then we can segue from there into where we think CrossFit might go.
Yeah, and before I start on there, I want us to clarify that when we speak of CrossFit as a sport, it's completely different than when we talk about for health and fitness. So we need to clear those lanes there. And also, not to throw them under the bus, when I talk about that, I talk about the high-intensity group model, right? So it's just CrossFit is just in our language of everything we're discussing, but it's happening, it's proliferating in a lot of spaces. It's not just that group. It's just that we're connected to it, so that's our language that we use. So like say 9 months ago, there was this, you know, massive opportunity. The way I used to describe it is like you played this field hockey tournament amongst 500,000 people to qualify you to play this street hockey tournament that was amongst like 3,000 people, which would qualify you to play this ice hockey tournament amongst 80 people. That's what the sport used to be like, okay? And that's not verbiage from my mouth, but that's just how language we described it before. But what that created was consistency. You had this ideal, right? You either did this 5-week long form intense piece that everyone did one workout a week, and then you qualified up to another level that was a weekend event to get you to where Marcus was talking about that he went numerous times. And that was kind of like the, you know, the structure. And there was some other competitions throughout that year where athletes can make a little bit money or get some more experience, et cetera, kind of like build their, you know, what I like to say, they get to learn how to elbow with some people and go face to face and like learn about themselves in competition. That was all good. So that was all stripped away in terms of a bunch of different ways where the open still stayed, which was the large, big front end piece. But now they created, I guess, just an ideal that was not as important. So the games were not as important. And so what they pushed out then was these sanctioning events that would happen numerous times throughout the year that would give people opportunity to get to that big show. So what that took away was a big, as I mentioned earlier, tens of thousands of participants who actually did it to get to the regional. And now you took, I would say, I'm going to like estimate, it's well over 10,000. There was a lot though that were just kind of like stuck and froze in time. It's like, what do I do now? Because they quickly realized there's no way I'm competing 8 times a year and traveling all over the globe. There's no way I'm going to win one of these sanctional events, right? So they quickly like realized after 30 seconds, right? After everyone was on, you know, everyone who was a gym owner or like who never coached any of these people were like, this is the greatest move ever. We love this idea, Terrell's health and fit. And everyone else was like, that's the fucking worst idea ever for the growth of a sport, right? You have all your raving fans, right? You got the top 3% who are like, we're good to go. We still make money and get sponsorships and I'm going to win a sanction, so I'm good. Then you had 10,000 people who were pissed. And then all the other people underneath who weren't really athletes. So they're like, oh, I don't fucking care. The Open's still going to be there. I can still participate on the weekend. So this fractioning that you had now, of course, creates this loose atmosphere as to what the sport looks like for the future. I'm going to just two things. I would posit that by 2028, we are going to have the Olympics. And there's going to be a medaled male and female Olympic medalist for functional fitness. And I'll do whatever I can to basically make that happen. If you reverse engineer that back, we will create structure and organization for the sport so everyone can do it. So we can define what the sport is, how it's done, how you move up, how you do it locally, how you do it regionally, et cetera, et cetera. Secondly, I think what's going to happen to CrossFit, I would say they're going to have a lot more sanctioning events to come because there's, as you can imagine, people can get on board to this new, you know, the people who have money, they're going to get on board to this new style and start owning like 5 or 6 events, like Timex for triathlons, or supplement companies for bodybuilding events, or et cetera, et cetera. So they see there's a money-making opportunity now in doing these sanctioning events, right? But in the end, what's gonna come down to for the coach and the athlete, it's gonna burn a whole lot of more athletes out, and now coaches have a real hard time of trying to figure out where they need to go to try to get this spot at this sanctional to get up to the highest point. So it's going to, there's a lot to be figured out. So if there's 16 sanctionals this year, I would say we're going to go north of 25 for the following year. On top of an open that's going to happen for the second time in this year, which is a 5-week stress point, on top of a games, which is going to be during the summer. So it's just going to be like all these opportunities to do the sport, which will, I'm just going to make an assumption that it's going to be a money-making opportunity only for the people that organize the sanctional events. And what's going to be left in the end is a lot of burnt out athletes and only the top that get to go to the games and they compete one time a year.
Wow. So do you, and again, I'm drawing parallels because I only have experience with other sports. In my brain, I was kind of thinking how we have some of our best NBA players go compete in the Olympics, but they'll still also do, you know, they'll compete in the NBA season. Is that going to be the equivalent of, or something similar to what you think might happen if CrossFit Games does get Olympic recognition? Do we see people competing in the games and then like, oh, but one day I'd also like to compete in the Olympics? Or which one do you think will take precedence?
Yeah, I'm going to say there's going to be a parallel opportunity, almost like a winter sport comparison as opposed to NBA. Mm.
Okay.
So in a winter sport opportunity, the athlete still has the opportunity to be self-responsible as their own brand to do whatever competitions they want to represent a certain sponsorship or a certain thing. But there's still going to be an ideal in the Olympic sports, which there is, right? And we know, and the reason why I use Olympic sports, because there's always this sweet, hard-ass story between the X Games and the Olympics, right? And if you dig into that, you'll see that there's a lot of great tension inside there, but it helps the sport grow entirely, right? It gets people bubbled up to do what's necessary to keep improving it. So I can see the sport offering that. I'd also love to see a more socialized, democratic version of it, which means that you have satellite locations for the sport that are paid for by the governing bodies or by private institutions that actually help these young athletes grow and develop into the sport. So it becomes a U.S., as an example, a U.S. Olympic Center training area for decades for people who want to participate in the sport, and they go there full time. The reason why I say I would want that to work that way is because as an athlete, you got to train 5 to 6 hours a day. As I said, this is one of these sports that you can't just snatch one time a week, be like, okay, I got my snatch in, I'm good to go, I can be a professional athlete. No. As you know, for a pro athlete, I would like to say it's like getting prepared for an MMA fight and you're really good and you're 3 months out, but you got to extend that out to 8 years, not 3 months, 8 years of that, like nonstop evolution of the sport, which means that from 19 to 27, you're going to be 24/7 training for the sport to either compete for your country because you're not going to have enough bits and pieces to compete in the public setting to make enough money.
That's really interesting. I got to thank you guys both. It's been really, really informative for me to kind of get an idea of the perspective of the sport, where it started, the differentiation between the sport and the health and fitness pursuit that we see at the boxes, the evolution of both of those, the perspective of the trainer, and how it ties into the evolution and changes in fitness in general, and now kind of talking about the future of where we're going. I guess at this stage, Omar, I think we could just open it up to see anything else they wanted to add, unless you Absolutely. Had questions you wanted to ask.
No, I was going to say that completely. Is there anything that we spoke about, guys, that you either want to add or either misconceptions, things that you want to clarify that we talked about? I do think that we covered a lot, and I think that you provided, both of you, great insight into CrossFit, as well as just lifting, I would stress in general, why we do it, and a whole host of other factors.
Yeah, I just like to reiterate the concepts of fitness and why we do it need to be on everyone's psyche, because it just gets lumped into, you know, the incorrect categories. Secondarily, I'd say we have to clearly, in our language as fitness professionals and in a medium like this, clearly define what we believe in and the difference between athlete and general population. And we can't intermingle those conversations. And even if we want to, because it's cool or there's science in it, it doesn't make it right for the consumer who sees our conversation they want to latch onto, because now they're latching onto a wrong intention. So, and then lastly, I'm happy to be a part of the resistance towards the resistance that I think, you know, captures all of what we're trying to do. I'm trying to do it at the gym level to give these coaches tools so they can help people realize that the resistance is going to be the savior. I'm speaking for Marcus, but I think that's his intention is to make it creative and enjoyable, to make people live long and prosper also. So I'm glad we're here for that.
Marcus?
Yeah, I mean, I'm just on the heels of this conversation, I think I definitely have I've gotten probably the most exposure over the years from being a CrossFit athlete, and I got into this whole mess because I wanted to figure out a way to deliver a healthcare system that involved basically lifting weights and eating real food. And that I'm glad that I've had the exposure that I've had through the sport of CrossFit. I still love the sport. I still love the sport of fitness and functional fitness, and I still have some aspirations of being able to do it better as I age. Maybe not, you know, physical my peak physical expression continuing to grow, but how do I do it with a family, and how do I do it with owning a business, and et cetera. But I'm still trying to take all the lessons that I learned from that, and whatever audience that I gain from those success years in the sport, to try and help people figure out what is the way to and use fitness as a tool to enhance their lives for a long, long time. Because that's what I continue to want for myself, for my family, and for my friends and the clients that I work with, and the people that see the sport of CrossFit as a super sexy thing that maybe they got told by the wrong person that that's how you live long and prosper. You go do CrossFit, what you see on TV. When in reality, if they buy into that message, they're going to learn pretty quickly, or maybe over the course of a couple years, that it's not how you live long and prosper. But to continue to fight the good fight of being like, well, no, like I'll be here to catch you when you hit that, you know, that burnout phase, or you get spit out the other end of it, and you think you have to go and find the next thing. Well, let's like keep working on collecting that group of people, teaching them how to connect with purpose in their training, give them tools that can be fun and engaging, but go back to the basic principles of resistance and bodybuilding and doing the stuff that's going to work for years and years and years to come.
Well said. Well, I just want to thank you both for being on. This has been a really, really engaging conversation. It's been challenging, and I think that's a great thing. And I think just for the listeners who may want to learn more about you guys and do a deeper dive for each one of you, James, can you let us know where they can find you?
Yeah, opexfit.com or thebigdogs.com. On Twitter, I basically just post my podcast that I listen to, if you're interested in what I listen to for that when I walk my dog or do easy aerobic work. And on Instagram at jfitzopex as well.
How about you, Marcus?
Yeah, revival-strength.com is our coaching group. And then Marcus Philly on Instagram and functional.bodybuilding on Instagram are two places to go and get just sort of my daily digest on fitness and movements that we're implementing. And those are great places.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Omar, you want to close this out, my friend?
Yes, sir. We've had myself and Eric, Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid. Now we've had the opportunity to have Morpheus and Neo trying to change the matrix. We want to thank James and Marcus for being on the podcast. All their information will be linked in the description, both on YouTube as well on iTunes. If you want to leave us a rating and review, it would help us out on iTunes. YouTube will be responding to comments. We appreciate everyone. We're back with another episode of Iron Culture every single Monday. We'll see everyone next time.